We've got Howell, Oregon, be a climate leader, and we've got speakers Rick Brown and Jana Gastellum of the Oregon Environmental Council, and they're going to talk about the climate change. As usual, we'll allow these 15 minutes for questions. Questions are for members of the forum, succinct questions, and I will then now turn the podium over to either Rick or Jana, whoever would like to come up first.
Well, good afternoon. I'm Rick Brown, and I'm a volunteer with 350 Oregon, also 350 PDX. We're sort of overlapping all volunteer organizations. We're, in effect, local chapters of 350.org, which you may have heard of. It's a U.S.-based global organization working on climate change, which we do as well. Knowing that and that I'm here to talk about climate change, you might, some of you guess that the 350 has something to do with perhaps parts per million carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and indeed it does. It's a target level that many scientists believe could give us a pretty reasonably safe climate at that level.
We're gonna swap mics. Forgive me. Kill mic two. Go live with mic two, please.
So with 350 parts per million carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, scientists say that may be safe. Just as a reference point, for the 10,000 years prior to the beginning of the industrial age, the carbon dioxide levels ran about 280 parts per million, and all the increase since then is due overwhelmingly to the burning of fossil fuels, coal, oil, and natural gas. Now, if you've been paying attention, you might realize that currently we're running right about 400 parts per million of CO2. And if you're really tracking things, you would know that in 2008-2009, when 350.org was formed, we were already at 380 some odd parts per million. So you might reasonably think that right off the line, we're doomed to failure, given that we're zooming well past our target level. But scientists tell us that that 350 level is still attainable. It'll take time. It won't be easy. Think of it as a aspirational goal, one that won't be seen in my lifetime or yours, but could conceivably be seen by the end of this century. And I promise this is about the last I'm going to have to say about parts per million carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. I've got all of four graphs that I want to show you. Two of them have something about parts per million CO2 in them, and then we'll be done with that sort of technical side of things. This is just kind of a quick look at where we are, where we have been in the recent past, and where we might be headed in terms of temperature, measured as global average temperature, a departure from pre-industrial times as the reference point. These and some of the other slides and what I'll say, I'll typically revert to degrees Celsius, the conversion to the more familiar Fahrenheit. I use that because that's what the scientists use. The conversion to the more familiar Fahrenheit is a multiplying by 1.8. Note in particular, right in about here is where on the red line we would reach something like 2 degrees Celsius over industrial levels. And then this whole red line is based on what the scientists call business as usual, the assumption that population economies continue to grow and that economies continue to rely on fossil fuels more or less in the way that we have in the past. And you can see that that line then continues and is approaching 5 degrees Celsius by the end of the century if nothing were to change. But also note that there's another line on this graph, the blue line, that levels off around 250, somewhat below a 2 degrees Celsius increase over pre-industrial times, and stays at that level all the way to the end of the century. And of course, the concern is not just about temperature, but what increasing heat in the climate system leads to: more droughts, more floods, more intense storms, reduced crop yields, higher prices, rising sea levels, the list goes on and on. Apologies. Just learning the technology here. And one thing to look at on this slide and the next are, keep in mind the trajectory of these two lines. The red line, the business as usual, keeps on up at pretty much the same rate all the way to the end of the century. The blue line levels off around 2050 and stays flat out to the end of the century. And you might imagine that the temperature trajectory tracks the trajectory of emissions of CO2. But this slide, which shows those projected emissions, shows that it doesn't quite work that way. And note in particular, the red line, the business as usual line, starts bending towards the end of the century, not quite leveling off. And it's due primarily to the residence time of CO2 in the atmosphere. Even when we stop or decrease emitting, the effects of the CO2 that's already been emitted keep having an influence, keep that line going up. And conversely, this lower line corresponds to the blue line in the previous graph, which was flat all the way to the end of the century. To do that, you need to peak fairly soon, drop abruptly, and note that at the very end of the century, this line goes below zero. And what that represents is a projection of dropping fossil fuel emissions to zero, and then the ability of forests and hopefully agricultural soils to take CO2 out of the atmosphere actually puts you into that negative mode. One thing to note on this graph, the others went to the year 2100. The time axis on the bottom goes all the way to 2500 in this graph. So even though that rising curve corresponds to the business as usual curve in the earlier graphs, it appears steeper because the time is shorter. The three descending lines from that come from imagining that we had a magic wand. This isn't, anyone else got one? I don't know what's going to. But that we could wave that magic wand and drop emissions to zero instantaneously. So the lowest curve assumes that that wand is brought into play in the year 2015, next year. And emissions drop to zero. This is what happens to carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And you can see that it drops below this dotted line of 350 before the end of this century. So that's what I said, our aspirational goal has some basis in reality. But the real important thing to learn from this graph is the consequences of delay. If you wait just another 15 years to 2030, that gives the middle line, and levels in the atmosphere don't drop to 350 until the year 2300. 15 years what, 200 years extension. And if we waited all the way to 2050 to do it, we still haven't dropped to the 350 level even by the year 2500. It's somewhere way out in the future. Again, it's the long residency of time of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere that influences, that there is a real penalty to procrastination. But again, there are multiple lines. We have choices. They're not simple. The path forward is difficult, and we need to act soon. But we can avoid the worst implications of climate change. Last slide, I promise. And this is just to point out an important aspect of all this discussion that often gets left out, mainly because it's not about climate as such, it's about ocean chemistry. And the blue line represents carbon dioxide rising in the atmosphere. As it rises in the atmosphere, so too does it rise in the oceans as is absorbed by them. In the oceans, it gets converted to carbonic acid. As acidity goes up, pH, which is represented by the red line, drops. CO2 in the atmosphere goes up, the acidity in the oceans increases, and that's not a good thing. Trust me, if you're a coral, an oyster, or one of the many forms of phytoplankton that have calcium-based shells. And in case we needed it, as a little reminder, climate change is going to affect essentially everything. And I would just add to this point that it changes everything for other than human life or more than human life on this planet as well. Dr. Hayhoe, in the last year or so, got some well-deserved recognition from her appearance in the Showtime program series, Years of Living Dangerously, primarily for her very low-key but effective communication skills, but also for the unusual fact, I think, that she is both a scientist highly regarded by her peers as well as an evangelical Christian. So those two can be brought together sometimes. This fine fellow is Bill McKibben. He's a writer, of a well-regarded writer. He's also a co-founder of 350.org. In 1989, he wrote and published the first book for a general audience on climate change, titled The End of Nature. And as you can tell by the picture, he's generally a fairly amiable and easygoing guy, but apparently he does have his days. In 2012, Bill wrote an article for the magazine Rolling Stone, another cheery title, Global Warming's Terrifying New Math. It turned out to be something like the most viewed, most downloaded, most liked article that Rolling Stone had ever published. And I suspect this picture was taken either when Bill really came to understand the full implications of his terrifying new math, or maybe it was when he learned that he was not going to be on the cover of Rolling Stone. Instead, they went with some kid from Canada that I'd never heard of. The math in Bill's article really focuses on three different numbers, only one of which I'm going to talk about much at all today. If you're interested in that article, which I recommend, if you just Google McKibben terrifying math, Google will take you to that as the first result. And the number from that article that I want to come back to is that 2 degrees Celsius temperature increase that I've mentioned several times before. long story short, that 2 degrees is the number that has internationally been agreed to, science-based, as the upper limit of what might be acceptable temperature increase. Beyond that point, there's no question that we're into the dangerous territory. The most recent agreement was in Copenhagen in 2009, where they added an additional wrinkle, a good one, I think, that we're not aiming to go to 2 degrees and stay there, but at most peak at that level and then return to maybe 1.5 degrees over pre-industrial levels. It's thought to be safer. I guess, you know, I think if you talked with some folks in the Philippines that were hammered by Typhoon Haiyan or currently drought-stricken Californians, they might say the slightly less than 1 degree rise that we've already seen is more than enough. But perhaps the most important thing that McKibben introduced in that article was the notion of a carbon budget, really a carbon dioxide budget, but it gets shortened to carbon. And the notion being that scientists have said if you have in mind a peak temperature, which it just so happens we do, based on the international agreement, 2 degrees centigrade, they can with fairly high confidence correlate that with the total emissions of carbon dioxide since the beginning of the industrial era. In this case, I was going to try and do it without using the number, but that's 1,000 billion tons of carbon dioxide emission would bring us to 2 degrees, a peak warming of 2 degrees. Just think of it as 1,000. That would be sort of a cap on CO2 that we don't want to exceed. If you have that number, and if you can then estimate how much has been emitted since the beginning of the industrial era, which scientists can do with some reasonable confidence, you've got the limit, the cap of 1,000. Subtract from that what we've already burned in the last 250 years or whatever. And the remaining amount is our carbon budget. It's the amount of carbon dioxide, carbon we could spend before we would reach that 2 degree limit. So it gives something that could be allotted by country or whatever. Frankly, we don't want to get even that close to 2 degrees, I don't think. So we've got 450 units that we can spend. Anyone care to guess how much CO2 we would put into the atmosphere if we burned all of the known reserves of fossil fuel, of gas, coal, and oil?
2,500.
I was going to round it to 3,000. I'm actually rounding down, but that's a very, very good and well-informed guess. So we've got a budget of 450, and we can outspend that potentially by 6 or 7 times. Trust me, we don't want to go there. If we're going to avoid truly dangerous climate change, most of the known reserves need to stay in the ground. And what we need to understand is that spending all of that 3,000 units of reserves is the business plan of the fossil fuel industries. They'll spend all of that and any more that they can find if we let them. And the reserves contribute about half of the worth of those fossil fuel companies. It is reflected in their share price. So if indeed policy becomes to reflect the reality that those reserves, 80% of them or so, need to be considered stranded assets that they'll never get to burn, that's going to have an impact on their share price. And that is the main reason why they fight so hard to resist policies that will change the trajectory of that original red line. They want to exploit it all. And the frustrating thing is that in most respects, the technology built around solar and wind, geothermal, other renewable sources, and along with conservation and energy efficiency, exist. And kind of the way to transition is reasonably well understood, at least the early stages of it. And we also have a pretty good handle on what the policies ought to be to go along with that. Stop subsidizing the fossil fuel industry to billions and billions of dollars every year. Reinvest in renewables and so forth. What we lack is the political will to implement those policies and get on that renewable trajectory. And it's important to remind ourselves there's no guarantees. We could meet all our goals in terms of reducing emissions, or we could fall short of those goals. We could try and fall short, or we could succeed in meeting our goals for reduced emissions and discover that climate still heats up and changes in undesirable ways to a greater extent than we anticipated. But the one thing I can guarantee is that if we don't try to meet those goals, we most surely will fail, which I don't want to do. 350 PDX, 350 Oregon, 350.org don't want us to fail either. And what we're focused on is building a grassroots movement to add to kind of the science and the other aspects of the argument that we already have. And it's important to recognize that doing things to change our own carbon footprints, solar panels, electric cars, whatever, those are important, but they're really not going to be enough. It's working at larger scales and working in the realm of public policy that's really going to bring us where we need to go. In my lifetime, and looks like most of us here in the room as well, there have been three major changes in public policy, changes in society that came about in part because of the development of movements to go along with them. One is civil rights, the other was the Vietnam War, and women's rights. And as it turns out, we're seeing the development of a movement on the climate issue as well. There were some 400,000 people that turned out for a march in New York City, along with 5,000 here in Portland back just a few weeks ago, back in September. One theme that we're using to try to educate about the need to act for action on climate change and to help build that movement is the notion of divestment. Excuse me. To stop buying stocks and bonds of fossil fuel companies, to over time sell off any that are currently owned. We're primarily talking about large institutional investors, though certainly doesn't hurt for individuals to do it as well, and to reinvest in renewable energy. Divestment is a strategy that's been around a long time. Originally came from the Quakers in the 1700s fighting slavery. It was used against Dow Chemical during the Vietnam War, and most recently it was used against apartheid in South Africa in the 1970s and 80s. And it's important to understand that it's not about, in some fashion, defunding the fossil fuel companies. It's about changing the conversation, changing the political will, generating political will for the sorts of changes that we need. to put some pressure on the state of Oregon to take action on climate, including divestment, we've developed the Oregon Climate Declaration. And it's puts pressure on about divestment. It educates very, very briefly about the need to leave most of the fossil fuel reserves in the ground, the need for reinvestment in renewables to create sustainable jobs and a more equitable economy. I have some printed copies of the declaration on clipboards at either end of the tables that could be passed around if folks would like to sign them. You can also go online to this web address and sign up that way. Better yet, you could send that URL, that address, to your friends and encourage them also to sign. And the very best thing you could do is set up your own signature page online and then have a new link that you could send to your friends to encourage them to sign up. If you ask nicely, I can do that for you. You can contact me at that email address. And with that, I think I'll close. Thanks.
The forum usually offers pro and cons. We made a considered decision that that basically debating evolution in 1931 was sort of appropriate, maybe more appropriate in 1878. But from looking around the discussion that we saw regarding climate change and the debates, we didn't think the opposite side is very credible. If the people feel differently, we can schedule the other position in the new year. And that's something we can talk to the board about when we are meeting. But Janet Gastellum is going to be speaking on the same side of the issue that Rick Brown was speaking on and provide up here. And that was a decision we made. If people disagree with that, I'm sure the new board will, I mean, the board will make some kind of arrangements for the other side. But it, frankly, when we were looking across the spectrum, the other argument just didn't seem credible. Most of it involved ad hominem attacks on Al Gore for having a house that used a lot of energy, or Robert Redford for flying around a private plane, or it had a religious basis. So we can be corrected, but today it's just be one-sided. So if you don't like it, blame me, and the board will reschedule.
Wait until I ask some questions.
Very good.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak with you today. My name is Jana Gastellum. I am the Climate Program Director for the Oregon Environmental Council. And I want to take off kind of where Rick left and talk a little bit about the history of climate action in Oregon. And I want to thank Rick so much for setting up the conversation so well. What I find so moving and inspiring about this issue, as so many other causes that are worthy of working for, is that there are so many volunteers dedicating a lot of their time to make progress on this issue. And Rick is one of those very dedicated people, and so it's an honor for me to be able to speak with him at this forum today. Oops. All right, I'm learning the technology as well. For those of you who are not familiar with the Oregon Environmental Council, we are a statewide environmental nonprofit. We've been around for over 40 years. We helped pioneer the original bottle bill, which then became a national standard. And so we think that Oregon very naturally has a leadership role in so many of the issues that we care about. But I do want to give you a little bit of background in how we work. So we're a multi-issue organization. We work on clean air and climate. We work for clean and plentiful water. We work to reduce toxics in the environment to protect the most vulnerable communities. And then we have two initiatives that kind of underpin all of those: a sustainable food and farm system, and then a sort of market innovation and economy, sustainable economy program. We work on three different levels. One with individuals like all of you. If you want to think about how you're going to express your own environmental values, we have tips and tricks for how to do that. We also work with businesses who want to integrate more sustainable business practices, and we help them find better markets for their products. And then as Rick noted, as important as individual action is for some of these big, big problems that we're facing, we simply need systems change. And so we have to engage at the political level. And so OEC works with our decision makers in Salem, we work with the governor, we work across the region, because we think that's very critical for the type of progress that needs to be made. So why do we care about climate change? Well, I came to this issue because it was ultimately about people. That we have a source of pollution and it's going to create inequalities both here in the US but around the world, and that there is a very human and real impact on this. Although I work for an environmental organization, you won't see a lot of polar bears in my presentation. They are also very important, very critical. But OEC tends to work at the intersection between the environment and humans and health, and so that's what I'm going to focus on today. So you have what are known as frontline communities. Who are the people who are going to be impacted? People who already have existing conditions, like our above average rate of asthma here in Oregon. Climate change is going to increase air pollution, and that's going to harm people with respiratory diseases. People who live in coastal areas, people around the world, but also our first responders. People have to deal with these crises. And so we have to be considerate of the humans who are in this equation. Just talking in the audience over lunch, someone mentioned the latest climate report internationally, and this just came out as part of these last international negotiations. This is very familiar from what Rick just presented. But basically, you can think about we need to cut our carbon pollution in half in the next couple of decades, and that we need to get down to zero by the end of the century. It's ambitious, but it's doable, and we're going to talk about some of the ways that we can get there. So I'm going to switch gears a little bit and talk about Oregon and where most of our carbon pollution comes from, because it's really important when we're talking about a problem to think about, okay, let's get down to some of the specifics and how we get there. So like most states, we have a mix of sources, but the really big ones are cars. Transportation sector provides the largest share of our greenhouse gas pollution. But surprisingly, coal is also a big part of the picture. We have only one coal-fired power plant in Oregon, but we also import a lot of coal-fired power. And because we demand that energy, we have a responsibility to think about how to phase that coal fire out, even though it's outside of our borders. So I'm going to focus primarily on cars and coal today as a way for us to just wrap our heads around this problem. So what have we done in Oregon? Well, Oregon was the first state in the nation to pass legislation related to carbon pollution. Back in 1997, we set a CO2 standard. And CO2, carbon dioxide, is the lead greenhouse gas and is often kind of shorthand. So you hear me say carbon and carbon pollution and CO2. That all kind of is shorthand for just that category of greenhouse gas pollution. So we set standards, and we said when we build new fire plants, natural gas fire plants, we want them to be at a certain efficiency level so we don't emit more pollution than is necessary. So that was excellent. We took an early lead, go Oregon leadership. Fast forward to 2007, we had a banner year. We created the Oregon Global Warming Commission. We created a renewable energy standard that said we're going to hit 25% renewables by 2025. And then we established climate goals, because that's really important. Again, when we're thinking about a big problem, we need to figure out where we're headed so we can break the problem down into steps that we need to take to get there. And I'll come back to those in a moment. In 2009, we also made significant progress. We had an emissions performance standard that said we're basically going to not build any new coal-fired power plants or contract for a long-term basis with other coal-fired power plants unless they were owned by utilities already. And then very importantly, we did something on the transportation side. We passed the Clean Fuels Program, which requires that our fuel importers, because we don't produce or refine any oil in the state, that they reduce their carbon pollution 10% over a 10-year time period. But the big piece of climate legislation at that point was to join the Western Climate Initiative and do a regional cap and trade program. And that was really important because that's an overarching policy that sets targets and drives emissions down in a very knowable and certain way. And that didn't pass the legislature. So where are we on our climate goals? Our first one was in 2010 simply to stabilize our emissions, and we did that. So we know progress is possible. We can sort of hold the line with where we're at. But in the long run, we need to bend those curves down. And so by 2020, we need to be 10% below our 1990 levels, which follows international science. And then we said at least 75% below by 2050. And I'm sad to say that we are not on track to meet our 2020 and 2050 goals. So here's a little look at where we're at. This was our original business as usual line. And you can see that our emissions were rising rapidly. And this is where we are today. And I just want to look at that real quickly. That's where we were, you know, 5-10 years ago. And this is where we are today. And that's because of dedication to this process. So some of this reflects nationally, we set car standards, fuel economy standards that are going to dramatically cut the amount of oil and gas we'll have to use. It represents a lot of energy efficiency work that we've done. So we've made a lot of progress already. This is very significant. We have other things that are already in progress. So we have a commitment to meeting 85% of all new energy needs with energy efficiency. But we have an opportunity to actually meet all new demand with energy efficiency. That's something that's very achievable. And that could drop our line down. We have our renewable portfolio standard. Remember that 25% renewables by 2025 goal? And we've had to defend that standard, which we've done successfully. But if we make sure that that standard plays out, that drops the line down. We have one coal-fired power plant that's going to phase out. And what we replace that energy with, if it's a mix of renewables and natural gas, if it's a cleaner mix, then we can drop that line further. And if we really fully implement the clean fuels program, which I'll talk about a little bit more later, we get back, you know, to starting to really level out and bend that line all the way down. But here's where we need to go. And what we need to do is figure out how we're going to fill in that gap. And what I'm going to tell you is that it's going to take a couple of different strategies to get there. But that's a good thing, because that means there's opportunity for new technologies and new opportunities, new job growth here in Oregon to help reach that. So different strategies. California, as a state, is really at the lead in the nation in figuring out how to really bend that line down. And what they did is they said, we are going to make our climate goals mandatory. So Oregon's goals are aspirational. No one is held accountable for reaching them. California says, we're gonna give someone the authority to come up with a plan on how we're going to reach those goals. And what they've done is they've come up with a bunch of different policies, 70 overall, to figure out, you know, different sectors, how we're really going to ratchet down emissions. And at the top, the one that people hear about the most is cap and trade. But that's really only 20% of what they're doing. So much of it is thinking about how we redesign our cities so that we don't have to be so dependent on cars, how we really improve energy efficiency in our houses. And so I really like this because it shows how much potential there really is to make progress. Now, we did sort of a back-of-the-envelope sort of look at Oregon, and our goals for 2020 are to get down to 17, but we're going to need, you know, a range of policies to get us there, and unfortunately, we'll still fall a little bit short, so we need to figure out how to really continue to make progress. So again, on this first one, cars, we have an opportunity in this legislative session to reauthorize this program. The program was passed in 2009, but with a sunset date, and we need to get that sunset lifted. And that will really be important for transitioning our transportation sector. And coal. So this has less to do with policy, but more to do with the fact that the Pacific Northwest is really becoming a throughput for a lot of fossil fuel resources looking for markets outside of the U.S. And this is where a tremendous amount of movement building has really happened. So there's the Alberta tar sands, which is unconventional oil. We have the Bakken oil fields, and we have Powder River Basin coal. And taken all together, if those export projects really come about, that'll be 5 times the amount of carbon that will come from Keystone. So it's been really important that we have honest discussions about what it means to be a throughput, even if we're not burning those resources here in Oregon. I also think it's really important to note that we're not doing this alone. There is regional collaboration. This is signing of the Pacific Coast Climate Action Pact. There's our governor, it's the governor of Washington and of California and the premier from British Columbia. And they said that together as a region, our four jurisdictions represent the fifth largest economy in the world. And if we collectively say we're going to make progress on climate change, that sends a signal around the world. And indeed, when leaders in New York met, they had a special section on West Coast leadership because we are really showing progress here. We have businesses that are signing their own climate declarations. And maybe there's some brands up here that you wouldn't expect. They're not all clean energy businesses. There's a lot of mainstream businesses who care about this. And in part, it's because we have a globally connected economy now. If you have a manufacturing center in Thailand and a typhoon hits, that's going to impact your business. If you care about food and food prices, droughts and severe weather certainly impact your supply chain and your business model. So we're very proud of the leadership that Oregon businesses are showing. Oops, this isn't working. There we go. And just because this is a political crowd, I wanted to end with a couple of polling numbers, because it's not just businesses and politicians who care about this. These are individual Oregonians. This is from the 2013 Oregon Values and Beliefs Survey, and it shows that 72% of Oregonians believe we should take action on climate change. And it wasn't just the west side of the state, that even in eastern Oregon, 2-1 people believe that we needed to make changes to deal with this issue, and now and not wait into the future. And people believe that public policy is important in addressing this problem. That's not just about changing your own light bulb, but really making systems change. But interestingly, people said the desirability for us to work together is very strong, but the probability on the left, the thought that we'll actually do this is low. And so I think that there is this cynicism about our political processes really being able to work collaboratively. And so that's where people feel like it's time for individuals to really stand up and be heard and form a movement around this issue. Rick showed you this photo as well, but this was extraordinary. 5,000 people from all backgrounds, young, old, faith leaders, health leaders, they came out and said, it's time for climate action in Oregon. So thank you so much. We look forward to the conversation. Thanks for your time, and we are excited to answer any questions.
Is Rick still around? Could you maybe move over here? Just the technical moving to answer questions, a bit easier if you're over here. And I see Marilyn McWilliams, who's got a question.
Marilyn McWilliams, and I also, as part of my duties for Tuolumne Valley Water District, I sit on the Metro Policy Advisory Committee, and I'd like to put a plug in that we will be finalizing our Climate Smart Communities program probably in December, and this will reduce the greenhouse gas emissions from automobiles. And I think you were talking about a movement. We want to get as much buy-in from the public. We've had great buy-in in terms of surveys and so on. But if you comment on how the consumers can back this Climate Smart Communities program.
That was a really great question. And unfortunately, in a 15-minute presentation, we can't go over all of the amazing things that are happening in Oregon. But Metro basically was tasked with coming up with their own greenhouse gas standards for transportation and coming up with a plan for how to reduce them. And it's a really wonderful stakeholder-rich plan that was put in place. And there was a public comment period open. And I don't actually know the end date for that. It's still open? If you would like to contact me afterwards, I can help relay that information. But really, public comment is so important in these processes. So please let people know that climate smart communities really do matter. Metro will be the first to come up with kind of a model plan, but we have a lot of other metropolitan planning organizations in the state, and they're going to need to look towards something that they can also model on. Thanks.
Chris Leslie, four member. This is actually for both of you or whoever can answer it. Isn't overpopulation the biggest problem? And in China, in Hong Kong in 1961, the smog was worse than in LA. This is where they cook over fires, charcoal fires, throughout China, and overpopulation throughout Asia. And I think that includes India. We have a huge population cooking old-fashioned over fires. Doesn't that really add to the lack of or increase of carbon dioxide? Billions of people.
There's no question that population is part of the equation. I'm not going to get it right. I think it was the Ehrlichs who came up with the very simple equation about how the environmental impact is the product of population, the type of technology, and the intensity with which it's implied, something like that, just three or four numbers. And population is a big part of that. I guess I would, I think we, there's something about our brains that wants to put us in sort of either or mode to think about single solutions. And I would prefer to say, yes, it's a big part of the picture. And, you know, it comes into play, especially where you've mentioned. We have our effect on the atmosphere through our high technology, our use of vehicles and so forth. A lot of the poorer population in Asia is not only affecting climate by burning wood and dung and other things, they're immediately affecting their own health. So we need to comprehensively deal with the whole thing of there's a whole separate population movement and effort that I commend, but we need to integrate that with dealing with the direct production of fossil fuel and other emissions that are changing the climate.
And the only thing I'll add to that is historically, the U.S. has been the largest polluter. China has taken over, but only recently as the number one polluter in the internationally. But I would agree, women's empowerment globally will be important for a whole variety of reasons, not only for climate change, but for education and other reasons. And so I'm personally a strong supporter of making sure that women are empowered around the world, not only for family planning, but for education. But still, when you look at the per capita carbon pollution, the U.S. is still the number one leader, and that even though there are a lot of people, they're living at very much lower carbon intensity lifestyles. So we still have to get our own house in order while we continue to do the important international work that we do.
My name is Bill Kroger. I'm a forum member, and thank you both for coming in. I'd like to say your presentations were uplifting. I read the New York Times story about the UN report over the weekend, and it's amazing, you know, when you have a gridlock Congress and everything, and you think, we're not going to get there. There's just no way. But, you know, so Jana, your report was good. Well, both of your reports are good, but, I mean, yours a little more uplifting. Well, anyway, back to my question. In the replacement of fossil fuels, one of the things I hadn't heard anything about was nuclear energy, and I was just wondering if it was playing a role at all.
I think there's no question that nuclear power plays a role in keeping emissions from being higher than they might be. And I'm sort of a nuclear agnostic, I guess. I have strong concerns about increasing the use of the kinds of nuclear plants that we have. There seem to be some always just at the horizon that would actually use our existing waste in nuclear plants, converting it both to energy and to far less toxic and long-lived products. And I think that may offer some real potential. But nuclear is extraordinarily expensive and very slow to get built. And I have concerns about diverting resources to that when there are other probably more cost-effective, less controversial less risky ways to, in the future, reduce our emissions. But I will acknowledge that the existing plants don't emit CO2, and that there's a benefit in that.
Lee Coleman, forum member. In his seminal work on fossil fuel versus remedies, Jeremy Rifkin in The Hydrogen Economy predicted that motor vehicles and buildings will, between 2015 and 2020, will begin to use more and more fuel cells, a process which produces as a main product hydrogen peroxide, otherwise known as water. Any comments from either of you on the subject of the advent of fuel cells in vehicles and buildings?
That's a good question. So Oregon's policy is making room for the future of hydrogen. So I mentioned the Clean Fuels Program, and one of the type of fuels that would qualify is hydrogen. We don't have any current hydrogen infrastructure in Oregon, but our neighbors to the south in California, they do. And they are, again, sort of maybe taking the lead on helping to develop that technology and infrastructure. I think likely hydrogen fuel cells will be used first in stationary applications where you don't have to worry about size and weight as much as you do in vehicles. But there still are automakers. I believe that Honda and Toyota in particular are really looking towards fuel cell vehicles. So it's one of those technologies that certainly is on the horizon. And if we have, you know, carbon revenue or other resources to invest, I think it is a very worthy technology to keep developing.
Hi, Phil Nelson, forum member. I just read This Changes Everything by Naomi Klein, who of course was here in Beaverton a couple of weeks ago with her new book. And one of the things that she mentioned was the coal export situation from Clatskanie and here right on the Columbia River. And I was wondering if you could give some specifics about that process of trying to terminate or reduce coal exports from our region, understanding perhaps that I've heard this, that about a third of the pollution in California and probably here comes from China. And those exports of coal are going to China, and it's going to come right back in our face. And in the light of what she's saying, I'm wondering if you have any comment.
I'll give it a try. I'll apologize for not being as on top of the details as I might like to be. But the whole exports issue is an extremely important one here in the Northwest. You might guess I'm a staunch opponent of the Keystone XL pipeline, which would take tar sands crude from Canada across the center of the country to the Gulf. But it's worth noting that if all of the proposed export facilities in Oregon and Washington, I think, were put into place, more than five times the amount of fossil fuels would pass through those than would pass through the one Keystone pipeline. So there's a lot of opposition. What comes back to us from burning that coal in Asia is not just the pollutants, the visible health-related pollutants that rain down on us, but of course the CO2 that comes from their burning mix into the atmosphere and affects us all on climate change. So it's very encouraging that Governor Kitzhaber has clearly expressed his opposition to further coal export terminals. There are a lot of folks up and down the West Coast trying to stop those. The expression is, we on the West Coast are the thin green line, opposing this massive expansion of fossil fuel use overseas. And but I've I've lost track of the particulars of individual facilities and where they are in the planning process. But if you sign our declaration, you'll get on our mailing list, and we'll keep you apprised of what's going on. Thanks.
Well, this ends the TV portion part of the Washington County Public Affairs Forum. Is a group of folks who are civic-minded, want to air issues for the public generally. We spend money televising this. We bring people in to speak, and it's all volunteer. So this will be, I think, my last meeting. I think Rob's going to do the last meeting with Professor Moore in 2 weeks. Professor Moore is going to do the election things. Unfortunately, I have a side job as a lawyer, so I have to be in court and on the coast then. So Rob will introduce some Professor Moore. That'll be the last of our programs this fall, I think, unless the board decides differently. Okay, we're off television, and ask your question, Harry.
Harry Bodine, forum member. You know, regarding Boardman and the export of coal, do we really expect the Chinese to freeze to death in the dark? They're going to get that coal. They're going to buy it someplace else. At least that's my presumption. Do we really expect them just to turn off the lights in China?
Well, I think that that's probably a false dichotomy. It's setting up sort of a false choice that has to be made. We're seeing in China that the building of very inefficient coal-fired power plants at a rapid pace has really created a lot of air quality issues, and that the Chinese people themselves are asking for cleaner solutions and opportunities. China's also investing quite heavily in renewables and energy efficiency. And so the hope and the ideal is that you leapfrog over the dirtiest and worst power that's out there and get to the cleaner stuff much more quickly. And so that's where I think the international community is looking at how we can help China make progress in that area. But certainly, as we've noted, population issues, but also the opportunity for economic development will drive different decisions and choices about the type of energy that's used. But I don't think anyone in the climate community is suggesting that anyone should have to freeze in the cold because of this. But rather, let's find better solutions for the energy that we need. Let's think about the highest and best uses for the carbon that's out there. And let's be really smart and strategic, because we can trade off some costs now for some very, very large costs in the future if we don't. And we have to get our arms around this problem. Otherwise, food prices, energy prices, all the things that we care about become much more at risk if we don't tackle climate change. And that's why people really feel like we have to make progress in the very, very near term, because the issue is too big and too critical not to do.
I'll just add one small point, something I read in the last week. It's about India rather than China, but I think the general principle would apply. Solar photovoltaics have dropped sufficiently in price that it's now more cost-effective to use solar in India than it is to use imported oil. So, and just recently, Deutsche Bank projected that here in the U.S. in 2016, that solar and coal would reach parity. And that trend, I think, is only going to continue. So as Jana said, it's not either or it's not it's a false dichotomy to think either you burn coal or you freeze in the dark. You can turn on the lights with solar power and the heat.
Chris Leslie, forum member. The forests, the loss of forests, is the oxygen that we breathe. Is there any other great quantity of oxygen being produced by anything that you know of that will help us be able to keep breathing?
Now you're touching close to home. I worked in forest conservation for 30 years here in the Northwest. At the same time, I don't claim to be a forest scientist. It's potentially a long and complicated answer, but there's a huge reservoir of oxygen in the atmosphere, and it built up over billions of years, mostly through the production of algae in the ocean. And the net action of forests is kind of in pre, you know, before we started exploiting them at huge levels, on an annual basis, it really nets out almost to zero. Forests produce oxygen and they use oxygen for growth at night or when trees die and decay. So the net influence is very low. And given the vastness of that pool of oxygen in the atmosphere, our ability to seriously deplete that is minuscule when you get right down to it. So as enticing a thought as it is, forests are not the lungs of the planet. They are wonderful things that have many values, but they don't, on a regular basis, provide us the oxygen that we breathe.
I could tell when my neighbor cut down six trees, huge trees, that I could not breathe as well.
Well, it may have been that it was warmer or something like that, but it shouldn't have been. With all due respect, it shouldn't have been.
No, I could tell I could breathe the oxygen. I could tell it was oxygen from those trees. Of course, that was, this is nitpicking, but thank you.
Thanks for your question.
Second bite of the apple here. In the year 1000 AD, the Earth's temperature was warmer than it is today. That's when the Vikings were settling Greenland and Iceland. Vineyards were growing in Norway, and there was no industrial revolution at that time at all. In other words, basically the climate goes up and down on a number of factors, doesn't it? Besides, obviously, human contribution, is a contribution. But on the other hand, if we stop the entire thing tomorrow, would we still get our 2 degrees in just on the normal ups and downs of climate on the Earth? Why were the Vikings so lucky, you know?
Must have lived right. A couple of things. I probably can't give you what you consider a satisfactory answer, but one is that 1,000 years ago, sometimes called the medieval warmth anomaly, something like that, actually wasn't global in effect. Now that we're getting more sophisticated ways of measuring temperatures around the globe, it was a northern hemisphere phenomenon and spotty even there. And I don't, if there's a good explanation, and there may well be, I'm not aware of it. But of course, climates always fluctuate. You know, we here on the West Coast are directly familiar with the changes from El Nino to La Nina. It's called the ENSO, the El Nino Southern Oscillation, and what the surface temperatures of the Pacific Ocean due to changes in wind pattern, how they influence both the temperatures, not just here in precipitation here, but globally. Part of the reason that temperatures have not risen as fast in recent years can partly be explained by the fact that we've been far more in La Nina mode than in El Nino. And what we're seeing now, really only in the last several decades, as the climate issue has become more prominent, is where, yes, there's noise in the climate system, just like there's noise if you're not properly tuned in on the radio and you get hissing and static and so forth. But just as you get closer to the signal, the sound, the program emerges from that noise, so too is the climate signal from our additional carbon dioxide emerging clearly from the more routine climate noise. And that's why the scientists are able, not only on the basic physics, but on the recent history of what they're actually measuring, able to say with the confidence that they do, for instance, in this most recent report that came out yesterday from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change.
Well, thank you for your attention, and that's all, folks. We have a short, thank you. There's a short board meeting to pick another date for a board retreat, and all members probably want to have some input into the things we talk about. So you know who we are, you know where you can find us. Rob Sullivan is going to be incoming president. Anthony Mills is going to stay on board. Nelson's going to be there. I'm going to be past president. I'm still going to be on the board for my fourth or fifth year, so I'll be around.
You'll never leave.
I'll never leave.
Gotcha.
But thank you. Bye-bye now.